that he came into this world, and we celebrate his birth this month. Amen. Amen. Now I hand over to Brother Bob.
Hallelujah. You all may be seated this morning. This morning, I just want to read a small portion of scripture taken from Psalms 84. And it says here, reading from verse 10, "For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. The Lord of hosts, blessed is the man that trusteth in thee." This morning, I must tell you that it's an honor, it's a privilege, it's a pleasure to be here this morning. So far with this virus, many didn't make it. And so far, many people choose not to come in the house of God for some reason. But you are here this morning. It tells you that it's better to be the doorkeeper in the house of the Lord and keep your salvation intact than to go and you do something else that is not worthy before Almighty God. And this morning, I must tell you that it's a blessing. When you make a choice, there's always a consequence. And life is about making choices. And there's good and there's bad. But thanks this morning, when I woke up this morning, you know, God reminded me that it's better to be in his house one day than be at all and elsewhere. No matter what is your struggle this morning and whatever you are going through this morning, whatever all the trials and all the temptation come and whatever knocks on your door, you are still here this morning, and God reminded me that your foot is firm and planted still by the river of waters, that in due time and season, you will bring forth your fruit and your body. And the Bible tells that your fruit will remain. Amen? Amen? This morning, I would like to invite Sister Esther. She come and do our announcement this morning. Praise God.
Pleasant. Good morning once again to each and every one of you. And we're so happy to have all of you in church this morning. Amen. Despite, you know, the busyness of the Christmas season, I know some of you made the special effort to be here. And give yourself a round of applause, you know, even as we come into God's house. So just a reminder of your announcement, our Wednesday night prayer meeting. It's from 7 p.m. And Friday night, from last week Friday, Pastor started the end times, you know, teaching, and we encourage you, you know, to come out if you can't make it. There's the live on Facebook that you could look at. As we go, we delve into God's word and learn so much that is needed at this time. Amen. So Friday at 7 p.m. and this Saturday at 7:30 a.m. we're having our women's prayer. Right? So we had the week before, you have a week off, and now we have every other Saturday. So this Saturday at 7:30 a.m., we encourage all the women who can make it, you know, to come out and spend time in prayer. Even as we come to the end of 2020, all we could do is just give God thanks that we are still alive. You know, that we are so grateful that he has been with us. He has kept us. Even through the good times, through the bad times, he has been there with us. Amen? Amen. And, you know, we just want to encourage you all, for those of you who may not have known, because of the guidelines given by the Prime Minister, we wouldn't be having any concert this year or dinner, but we encourage you to give. Even though we can't come and fellowship together now, we encourage you to give to those less fortunate, to those in need. It could be in the church, in your community. And as we give, God will bless us. Amen? Amen. All right, I now hand over to Brother Bob.
Praise God. This morning, I would like to invite Sister Aaliyah. She will do a special for us this morning. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Good morning, church. The name of my monologue is Joy Comes in the Morning. My name is Elisheba. You may know me better as Elizabeth. My name means God's promise. Growing up among my friends in the village, we all look forward to marriage and growing families. I am a direct descendant of Aaron, the first high priest, and so is my husband Zachariah. His name means God remembers. We try to live a godly life and expect it to be blessed as an example to everyone of how God blesses obedient people. Every month I face my own disappointment and that of my husband. I felt I was letting him down. I know he felt it too. So much for God remembers. My arms ache to hold a child, but every month my womb wept. Eventually, I passed the age of having children, so my womb stopped weeping, but I didn't. It was so hard to hold my head up year after year, serving God faithfully with no results. My name, God's promise, was a mockery. I felt abandoned by the God we serve. When Zechariah went down to Jerusalem, at the temple, worse was to befall him. An angel visited him, and because the news that finally we were to have a son was too hard to believe, he was struck dumb. Imagine my terror on his return home. I didn't know whether to laugh or cry. I did both. I laughed at the idea of pregnancy at my age and cry for the situation with Zachariah. I didn't believe I would have a baby, so Zachariah would be dumb for the rest of his life. It seemed we were being punished further. But when I started feeling sick every morning, all that turned into joy. God vindicated us in the eyes of the people. Everyone knew that God had wrought a miracle in our lives. I was 6 months gone when I had a surprise visit from my young cousin Mary. As she called my name, it felt as though my baby was doing somersaults in my womb. He was leaping for joy in the presence of the Messiah that Mary was carrying in her womb. The Spirit of God showed me that she was carrying the promised Savior. Then the lights went on. I understood. We were in this together. If she were carrying the Messiah, I must be carrying the promised messenger, just as Isaiah had prophesied. The angel said that my son will be like Elijah, bringing people to repentance. And my name, God's promise, was not just for me, but for everyone. There are plenty of children to take their place in the palace, but when they grow up. But my child is to announce that God's promise to the world has arrived. What an honor. Forever after, people will talk of Mary and how she was chosen, but so was I. All those years of tears and anguish to be part of God's salvation, they were worth it. Tears may fall in the night, but joy comes in the morning.
Hallelujah. Like the last part of the monologue. Your tears may come in the night, but your joy cometh in the morning. Hallelujah. Shall we all stand this morning as we go in a time of worship? Hallelujah. And this morning, give God your best this morning. Hallelujah. Worship Him in spirit and in truth this morning. Hallelujah.
Oh,
midst of whatever we're going through. He's still holy. He's still in control. He still loves us this morning. Even if you're hurting, even if you're not even feeling to worship this morning, we know that He's still holy. He's still on His throne. And all the honor and all the glory belongs to Him this morning. Amen. We just worship You. We just thank You.
Who comes to preach? It's God's word. It is not us. It is Christ, the hope of glory, living in us. Hallelujah. This morning I would like to welcome our Reverend Patsy Budrum as she brings God's word this morning. Give God praise in the house this morning. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God.
Come on, let's change for Jesus this morning. Amen. Amen. That still was sung alive for somebody else, not Jesus. All right, so let's hear it for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords this morning. Praise the Lord. Pleasant good morning to all of you. Amen. It's a joy, it's a privilege, as Brother Bob said, to be in the house of God. Amen. We thank God for life this morning. We thank God for His love. Amen. Towards us. Amen. While we were yet sinners and bad boys and girls. Amen. Jesus came and died for us. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. We thank God this morning for a wonderful day that we will rejoice in it. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. The Lord. This morning is communion morning. Alright? And this emblem placed in front here that represents the body and blood of Christ is all because of love. Amen? Because of love, we have this. That we can sup together as a family. Amen? So this morning, my topic will be God's love. Amen? God's love. Amen? And it's because of God's love I am here. Because when we had a problem, we tried everything. And nothing helped us. But when we came to Jesus, because He died on the cross for me, my family, you. And this is why we are here this morning, because of the love of God. Amen. So this morning, my scripture will be taken from Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18, verse 11 to 13. Matthew chapter 18, verse 11 to 13. Yes, we have place in front here, so you can come. Yeah. Where is our usher? Where is Hansraj? Yeah. Okay, he said, "For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save which was lost. How think ye, if a man have 100 sheep, and one of them be gone astray, doth he not leave the 99 and goeth into the mountains and seeketh that which is gone astray? And if so be that he findeth, verily I say unto you, he rejoiceth more of that sheep than of the 99 which went not astray." And then John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Amen. And John chapter 15, verse 12 and 14, he said, "This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you." Verse 13, "Greater love has no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friend." Amen. And are you happy that you are a friend of God? God called us friend. Amen. Even though we do our own thing, God still calls us friend. Because he said he laid down his life for his friend, which is you and me. Amen. So we thank God for his wonderful love. Amen. Praise the Lord. So here now, as we get into the word. First of all, there are 8 types of love according to the ancient Greek. 8 types of love. First, we have philia, which is affectionate love that is without romantic, right? Attraction that is between a friend and a family member. You know, sometimes you have a friend and you really love that friend, but it's not no romantic friendship. It's just a nice, loving friendship you have with one or the other, right? Or sometimes you have in a family member, you say, "Well, you know, this is my best cousin, or my best niece, or my best auntie." You had that close friendship with them. That is what we're talking about this morning, right? Philia. Then we have pragma, enduring love, committed love, or a long-standing love that you have for somebody or with somebody, right? Then we have storge, S-T-O-R-G-E. It's a familial love. It is like between a parent and a child, how they love the child or the children. It is like that, right? Or sometimes you may have a pet and you love that pet so much. It is that kind of love we're talking about, right? Or sometimes you may have you're working and you have a colleague and always real buddy-buddy, like that. Right, then we have ludus, L-U-D-U-S, playful love. Right, so sometimes you have somebody and you're talking nice with them, you're there with them and thing, and you're close and thing. And sometimes they might feel a little butterfly in the stomach. But that time you had that kind of love for them, right? But they might be feeling that. You know, you ever hear them talk about you feeling butterfly in your stomach? Anybody ever hear that? Come on, we're going to talk this morning, right? Because sometimes when we're talking about, sometimes we come in this kind of topic and sometimes we quiet, but we know every single thing. You know? We plain holy than thou. No. Come on, you have to talk. Right? So, that's how it's supposed to be. Right? And then we have philotia love, a self-love where you love yourself. Right? And then we have eros. This is where the romantic love that is between a husband and a wife. That is not between a boyfriend and a girlfriend, eh? That is sin. This is between a husband and a wife. Right? Because nowadays, now, a boy have a girl and a girl have a boy. Them doing everything. like husband and wife, whereas it's not supposed to be like that. It's only when you're married, right? So, sometimes when we hear this kind of teaching in the church, we may want to say, but what's she preaching about? Or what's pastor talking about? Hear me. It's in the church we have to talk it, and in we home with each other. Right? So as I say, this eros love is between a husband and a wife. It's not between a boyfriend and a girlfriend. But now it's so different. By the time a boy meets a girl or a girl, it's like a husband and wife. Right? But that is sin in the sight of God. Then we have mania love, obsessive love, or jealousy or anger. And we see it happen in our country. Right? We see it happen. So sometimes people love somebody and they say, hear me, you see you, girl? You can't talk to nobody else. Otherwise, I will kill you. And we see it happen. You know, it has some husband. When they go outside with a wife, hear me, they're talking, eh? I know some people about that. He has some wife. When they're there with their husband, they are talking to you. If they're by themselves, they're talking. Me and Pastor. Pastor could go wherever. Any girlfriend could come and meet, he hug, he up, kiss, see, all kind of thing. Because you see, I know our relationship, that don't bother me. And it's the same thing. I could talk to whoever, that don't bother Pastor. He don't want to know, but who is that you're talking to? No. You know, so that's how we're supposed to be. You know, you trust each other. Don't be jealous. I tell you, he has a man. The wife can't talk to nobody, and the husband can't talk to nobody, you know. No. So come on, we need to take care of that. And then we had the agape love, right? Which is a selfless love. That is the unconditional love of Jesus Christ. And this morning, this is what I want to focus on, the agape love, right? That is God's love for everyone. It have no barrier there. God's love have no boundary. Amen? It is a love without limitation. It is a love that has no end. Right? And whatever is your fault, God still loves you. All right, so this morning we focus in on God's love, the unconditional, unchanging, unending love. Right? Because sometimes a man and a wife could have love for their wife. Sometimes it lasts a month, 2 years, 5 years, 15 years, and then you see things change. But God's love remains the same for you and for me. We can trust God. We can put our whole life in the hands of God. And there was a song that said, the arms of flesh will fail. Right? Put all your trust in Jesus. As John 3:16 said, for God so loved the world. Amen. God sent his only son, Jesus Christ, to die for you and for me. Amen. It's all because of love. And let me tell you something. God never select anybody. And you say, you see, that rich person there, I'm going to die for he. No. I said it was for each and every one of us. Amen? Right? God did not select anybody. Right? He chose, you know, you have a little arm. Is that sure? The good, the bad, the ugly. Everybody, but hear me tell you, there's nobody ugly in the sight of God. Right? God made us in his image and likeness. We were made in the image of God. We kind of resemble God. In his image. right? So God did not choose anybody to go special to go and die on the cross. No. You could be rich, you could be poor, you could be an old person, you could be a beggar, you could be who? Jesus came and died for one and all. Amen. When you think about Peter, he was a cussbud. He cussed him day and night. I say cuss him because that way we just say it in Trini language. Right? But it's really curse. But we just say cuss. Right? So, I come to your level. So he died for Peter. Peter was a cuss body. He didn't say, well, you see, Peter does cuss so much. I'm not going and lay down my life for he. He will lay down his own life. No. As I say, he did not pick and choose anybody. Right? What about the woman at the well? She had 5 husbands. And Jesus said, you see, I'm going to die for this woman. And he took that woman's place on the cross. Amen. The drunkard, Zacchaeus is a thief from everybody. He was a tax collector and he used to go and rob them. But Jesus said, I will go and die for this person because I know one day he will give his life over to me. All right, so we see here, and as a little song said, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. So all of us are precious in God's sight. Amen. This is why he chose to go and die for you and for me. Amen. So we went down here in the Bible where it said, if a man has 100 sheep. Esther, you ready? Ready, keyboard? He said, if a man have 100 sheep and one gone astray, doth he not leave the 99 and go in search of that one sheep that went astray? That is how the love of God is to us. Amen. He leave that 99 sheep there and went and look for that one that went astray. So that is how God's love is. Amen. Because he know the 99 is safe. So he said, I will go all the way and look for that one lost sheep. And when he found it, he came back rejoicing. And when one sinner come to Jesus, there is rejoicing in heaven. Amen. Hallelujah. That is God's love for us. As we just spell it part of the song. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Thank you, Lord. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still, you away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah.
Thank you, Lord, for your love.
Your fault, still your love far from me. You have been so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so and oh, the overwhelming.
Yes. That's the love of God. He will go all the way. Amen. When we go astray, he's there to draw us back to him. Amen. The Bible said, we all was like lost sheep. We all have went astray. We all went our own way. But thank God for his love. Amen. Thank God for Jesus. Amen. That he came and found us. Jesus found us. Amen. Amen. When God spoke to Jesus, when he see the condition we was in, God spoke to his son and said, son, would you go and die for the world? Would you go and die for all these sinner man and sinner woman? Jesus replied, yes, Father, I will go. Amen. So this is why John 15:13 said, no greater love than this, than a man will lay down his life for his friend. If we do and keep the commandment of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Romans chapter 8, verse 38 to 39, it talks about what can separate us from the love of God. Though the trials and the problem may come, what can separate you from the love of God? Amen. Don't let COVID separate you from the love of God. Yes, we have to be protective with ourselves and our family. But don't let COVID come and separate us from the love of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. So we see here, Jesus died on the cross for you and for me. He bore our sin and he bore our shame upon himself. Imagine that. He took that 39 stripe on his back. Nisha, I don't know if you can get a picture or the little video clipping. You must see it on the Passion of Christ. You know, when he took all that pain for you and for me upon himself, that 39 stripe that he took, the Bible said, blood and flesh came out of his body, and it's because he bore all those things on himself because of love. Nobody will do that for you. Not a husband, not a wife, not a child. Nobody. But we thank God that Jesus went on the cross and he died for you and for me. Amen. The nails in his hand. The nails in his feet. Just imagine this. Just look at this little clip in here. You think you could take some of that? No. Mother seeing her son going through all this stuff. When you read the commentary and things, they say when they hit Jesus with that, with those whip with the hooks on it, they say flesh came out. Blood. The blood he shed was for our cleansing. Amen. Right, so you can just hold it there. Amen. So we see what Jesus had to go through just because of love for you and for me. So we see here, Jesus' love was proved not by only words. And you say, I love you. No, but by action. On the cross of Calvary. This is why we sing the little song. He was nailed to the cross for me. On the cross crucified. For me he died. He was nailed to the cross for me. So we see here, God's love is unconditional. As we sing that, as we play that song, the reckless love of God. I was listening to that song. So I said, Pastor, I say, but how do you say God's love is reckless? You know? God is not mad. Right? So, as I went and read, and the definition of reckless is careless of consequences. Because what Jesus has to go through for us, he didn't care. He didn't care less. He said, yes, I will go. Though they beat me, they stab me, they spit on me, I will still go and die. Right? So that was the definition of reckless. Amen? That God did not care about himself. He did not concern about his safety or his comfort. He said, yes, I will go. He could have remained in heaven there now. And we could have had to fight it out for myself. Or somebody might have to put me on a cross and die for my family or something. I'm just saying. But no, he didn't care less. He said, yes, though they kill me, I will go and die for the world. That is love. That is love. Jesus gave his life for us. He went through the pain and the suffering. I say he did not care less. It comes like, let me say, Brother Bob, your home catch a fire. And Shalini inside the home. What will he do? You will go and try to save Shalini? Or you will leave she there to burn out? Right, you will go and try. So it's the same thing. Right? You would go and try. If you see your house caught a fire and you know your child or children or husband or wife inside it, you will make an effort to go and save that person. So it's the same thing with Jesus. With all that he went through and he looked up and he said, yes, I will go and save my brother, my sister, my child. Amen. Hallelujah. So we see here, Jesus was not forced to love us, but he chose to love us. And with open arms, he chose to love us. Amen. So we see here, Jesus' love is beyond what we can comprehend. As we read the scripture here, just as the shepherd who lost that one sheep, he went in search of that sheep. Right? And probably when he go there, he might see some other animal trying to come at that sheep, and that shepherd would try to fight it off. Right? Because he wouldn't stand there and see, well, a big wolf or something coming to kill my sheep, and I was, no. He will do something. He might have a stick or something and try to hit it off or drive it off or something. So it's the same thing with God's love towards us. God didn't sit there in heaven and say, here, man, let them fight for themselves. He said, no, I will go and die for them. Right? And it's the same thing. God loves us so much that sometimes when we're going through our pain and our suffering or the enemy comes before us, he come and defend us. Right? God comes and defend us. So we see here, God love is not as human love. As I say, sometimes we love for a month, 5 years, 15 years, 20 years. Amen. But God love is everlasting. God's love has no ending. Amen. Yes, we have our husband and wife and children. We love them, yes. But you know, sometimes after some years, it just turns sour. Anybody know about that? Yes. It just turns sour. So come on, put your trust in Jesus Christ. You know, sometimes when a boy meets a girl and think, oh gosh, as Pastor said, the heart will start to palpitate and this and that. You know, and then sometimes mother and father talking to you, you want to hear nothing. I love them, and that is it. No matter what comes, I love. That time you forget about the love of Jesus. Yeah, that time you forget where Jesus bring you from, and you get blind. They say love is blind. Is that saying? They say love is blind, but it's true enough. Yeah, love does really blind some people. Amen. And then they will tell each other. That time you come and you're singing, Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Then after I hear the song, then they change. Then it changes a different song you're singing when you get tangled up with boyfriend and girlfriend. You know? It's a different song you're singing. Then they say, girl, I love you with all my heart. My body, my soul, my spleen, my liver, my guts, and all kind of thing, you know. All kind of thing. I don't know, recently, I hear people say, I love you from the moon and back. Why is that? The only person I know went to the moon was the astronaut Neil Armstrong. All kind of thing, when you get fall in love, it's so much of all kind of fancy thing and nice thing, you know, you're saying. For the longest while I hear Pastor. You know what I say? He's saying, Jesus, I love you. When he kneel long and he praying in the room, he said, Lord, I love you. And you know what he does do? Sometimes he just send a kiss for the Lord. Yes. He's expressing his love towards Jesus Christ. And we need to do that. And I say, it's a long time, Pastor. Tell me that. You can remember when last time? Right. So we are lying in the house of the Lord. But I say, I would hear him praying and saying, Jesus, I love you. Lord, I love you. So you know, sometimes before we get married, I think we're telling Jesus how much we love the Lord. How much with my whole heart and body and soul. And then when we get married, I think it's a different song. We sing it, we see sometimes, you don't care to do things for God anymore. You know? Yeah, care. The love going cold for Jesus. Yeah. Amen. Sometimes you're in ministry and you say, well, you don't care again. Yeah. That time my wife come first, my husband come first, my children come first. And you put God there a little backwards. Amen. So we see here. Solomon. The songs of Solomon. When you read that book, Solomon, it speaks so much about all his wives he had. He had 400 wives and how much concubines. You know? And he would explain to them the love and how he will call them. Right? This is from the word of God. Here how Solomon described some of them. Solomon chapter 4, he said, behold, thou art fair, my love. Behold, thou art fair. Thou has dove's eye. You ever tell your wife that? Or they just say, look into my eyes. And when you get up early in the morning and you look into the eyes, what you see? Yeah, Maya, you could help me preach. It said, thou art fair, thou hast dove's eye within my locks. Thy hair is as the flock of goats that appear from Mount Gilead. He said, thy teeth are like a flock of sheep. Could you imagine how much? Right? And that are even shorn, which came up from the washing. Thereof, everyone beareth twin, and none is barren among them. He said, thy lips are like a thread of scarlet. It bringing back some memories to you all when you all now meet your husband. All the nice things you used to say. He said, thy lips are like a thread of scarlet, and thy speech is comely. Thy temper are like the piece of the pomegranate within thy locks. He said, thy neck is like a tower of David, built for an armory. And you can read the books of Solomon. How Solomon used to describe, you know, his wives. You know, but yet he had all these wives, and you know what happened? They turned his heart against God. Right? His love for God wasn't there because he had so much. They turned his heart from God because he married some wrong people. Yeah, when God tell him, do not do this, do not marry this one, do not, but he didn't listen. And sometimes it happens. Sometimes we're in church, we're in ministry, and sometimes somebody come our way and we marry the wrong person. And you know what happened? They help me to backslide. Yeah. That's 2 weeks back. I heard. Serving God, and you know what is right and what is wrong. But as the old people that say, you see, when you're now married, sometimes that is the time your eyes just open. That time you're seeing somebody better than your wife, better than your husband. Don't talk if you're working. Oh gosh, and in the office, and somebody bring a nice flowers for you, and you are getting that home, eh? Your husband or your wife are bringing nothing for you. And you got a nice, somebody bring a nice rose for you, auntie. Oh, gosh, well, you get, let's say, heads over here. You know? So, come on. And then it have this, I was saying a little joke. Then they will come and they say, I have found, all these years, I have found you tried and true. But now I am tired of you. Yeah. I hear that little story. They say this man and his wife, they had to celebrate their anniversary, and the man had was to come and say something. And he said, all these years I have found you tried and true, but now I am tired of you. Amen. Is that true love? No. We made a vow when we married, for better, for worse, for richer, for poor, and so and so and so. We had to stick it through. We had to stick it through. Amen. We have to stick it through, especially when we know Jesus Christ. You know, sometimes we tend to look and talk so much about the unsaved. But we have so much of things in the church with family lives and all kind of things. So much of things happening and we keep it quiet. Come on, no. When you know Jesus, come on, you can put it to him. You have people you can talk to. Sometimes we need to talk and get things out of us. Yeah. All right? What about, we see here, the prodigal son, his father's love remained the same for him. Although he went astray, his father used to always look out and say, hear me, son, when you come, my arms is always open to you. He went astray, took all his money and went and squandered it. But yet he will look out every day when my son will come back. This is how God's love is. Don't mind you go astray. God's arms is wide open. He said, you can come back to me, son. You can come back to me, child. I am here. Like many times we think love is a symbol of a heart shape, but no, love is on the cross. That is love. I don't know if you can get a picture of that, Nisha. That is love, where he died on the cross for you and for me. Sometimes people will say, well, I love you. They send a little card with a heart in it. And sometimes some of them have an arrow in it. Hear me, you're getting stabbed too now, you don't know. Yeah? Sometimes they're sending it with an arrow, but yeah, you're getting stabbed. Because you know why? They have a little deputy's angel on his side there and you don't know. And they're saying that it's okay to have a little spear tire. They call it spear tire. Yeah. They say when that one busts, I have a next one, I'll take it out and I'll put it there. And you want to roll again. Yeah. But hear me, God's love is not like that. Jesus' love is not like that. Amen. When you see all the beating Jesus went through on the cross, that is love. Look at this photo. That is love. Just imagine that. If you would just close your eye and visualize, you know that Jesus on the cross and the licking his gift, how they take the pierce and the push it through his side. The Bible says out of that came blood and water. Everything Jesus had in his body drained out because of his love for you and for me. Amen. And he loves us so much. As we play a little piece of the song, Excessive Love. Amen. God's love is unending. Amen. I have a little quote here. He said, God loves you more in a moment than anyone could in a lifetime. Just imagine. In a moment. A moment is like a little. That is how God's love is to us. So you find the song? That is how God's love is to us. Hallelujah. You right where you are, you can worship him, you can thank him for his love. Yes, Jesus.
Your love is high.
That's God's love.
Jesus, you love me too much. Oh,
that you went and took our place. Yes, that's the love of God. Amen. His love is enduring. His love has no end. We thank you, Jesus. He brings peace and joy in your life. Amen. When you experience the true love of God, that is what it's all about. The love of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes, he loves you. So when you come on, you need to pour out your life. You need to pour out your heart to God and say, Jesus, I love you. It's not that we just murmuring something, but it's coming from deep down inside of us and say, Lord, I love you. I don't care who's watching me, but I want to lift my hand and I want to praise God. Amen. Because he died on the cross for you and for me. He shed his blood. That is love. That is love. Amen. So this morning, it's communion morning. We see here how God demonstrated his love for us by leaving this emblem here, his body and blood. He died for us. Amen. He died for us. He said, do this as often in remembrance of me. So when we take this communion, we remember all the suffering that Jesus went through on the cross. Amen. Yes, his love is amazing. Amen. When we think about the great love of Jesus. So this is something here very important to us. This is a gift that God has given us to prove his love to us. Just as sometimes you will get something from your husband or your wife and you cherish that and you keep it. Sometimes when they die, you will say, you see this? My wife or my husband gave me this. And I will cherish this and I will keep this star. I will remember him. So it is the same thing with Jesus. When we come, we must have that same relationship for the Lord. Just as we have it for our husband and wife. Have the same love for Jesus. So this emblem here represents the love of Jesus. He shed his blood. He gave his body for us. Amen. As we see here, love is a sacrifice. He sacrifices life for you and for me. Amen. So we say, even when Jesus was betrayed, he showed love. He showed love. Even when he was going to be betrayed, he showed love. Amen. So I have a song there. If I hand over to Pastor, I want to play this song. It's a Hindi gospel love song to the Lord. To the Lord. The name of it is Tedi Pia He Maha. And we know Pia is love. Amen. So he said, Jesus, your love is great. Jesus, you are my king of my heart. Amen. So whatever language we are able to express our love to Jesus, and he knows. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus. Right where you are sitting, thank him for his love. Thank him that he went on the cross and died for you and me.
Lift up your hammer, Yeshua, Yeshua. Lift up your hammer, Yeshua.
We have the English meaning there. I don't know if you all can see it.
Main tha tujhse door, bebas aur majboor.
Thank you, Lord.
Par tune mera naam le. अपने हुजूर और दिया जीवन भर तेरा प्यार है महान यीशु यीशु तेरा प्यार है महान यीशु मेरे दिल का राजा है तू यीशु मेरे दिल का राजा
Jesus, you are the King of my heart. Thank you for his love. Yes, Jesus.
You're in my heart. You're in sets my heart on fire like you do, no one else could ever love me like you do.
Yes, Jesus. No one else can love you as how Jesus loves you. Amen. So this morning, I just want to hand right over to Pastor as we go into our communion. Amen.
What a powerful message this morning. Come on, give the Lord a big clap. Hallelujah. Give our minister and servant a big round of applause. Well explained, well articulated, and putting together the music, the videos, man. It was a great blessing. I thoroughly enjoyed the ministry of the word, using all the facets, amen, of learning so that the message could go deep down in our our spirits. Will you bless this morning? Come on, give the Lord a big clap. Hallelujah. Yes, no one. Yes, you could let this song play. Hallelujah. Endure the communion. Friends, regardless of whatever language we use, love is universal. Amen. Just like hallelujah. In whatever language, they still say hallelujah because it is the highest form of praise. Hallelujah. We want to go into our communion this morning. We ask Brother Bob and Sister Patsy to come. Let us prepare our hearts to supper at the table of the Lord. First Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which you have betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup. When he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. At this time I ask Mr. Vatsi to pray and then Brother Bob, and they will place the elements and you come and take your portion, go back to your seats, and we'll partake together as one family.
Praise the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your love, Lord, towards us, my God. Lord, and this morning, Lord, as we lift up, Lord, this emblem, my God, that represents your body, my God. Lord, I pray, Lord, as we partake, my God, Lord, let it bring healing to our body. Let it bring, Lord, strength, my God. Let it bring, Lord, salvation, my God. Lord, most of all, my God, help us, my God, to remember, my God, what you did on the cross for us, Jesus. Lord, that you went and you took, my God, our place. Lord, and you paid a price for us, Jesus. Lord, and we thank you, my God, for your great love towards us, my God. And help us, Lord, to love you back in return. Lord, and I give you thanks and I give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Almighty God and our Heavenly Father, we do give praise and thanks unto you, Father, and we bless your holy and your matchless. Thank you, Father, for the privilege and the opportunity we have to supper at your table today. And Father, we are ever grateful and thank you for all that you have done for us and our families and for humanity. Father, I lift this emblem that represents the blood of Jesus Christ. I sanctify it in your name, Lord Jesus, and I bless it in your name, Lord Jesus, and we receive it with thanksgiving. And I pray even as we go to partake, Father, that we will judge ourselves and make right with you and make sure that we are worthy partakers. Father, I pray, O God, that you will help us this morning. Forgive us of every sin, every iniquity. Wash us and cleanse us this morning with your precious blood, Lord Jesus. And make us instruments of holiness and righteousness that we be able to partake as one body in one accord. And Father, I just thank you and I lift this emblem and give praise and thanks in Jesus, your Son's mighty name. May it bring strength, may it bring remembrance, and may we, Lord, live to please you all the days of our life till we see you face to face. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this privilege and opportunity in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
As you place the elements here, you know you can come. Make sure you have social distancing. And you wish to bring your offering as well. Bring your offering and come take your portion. Go back to your seat. and we'll partake together. You could raise the music.